in Bali, it's pretty normal to put ice in your beer. So this is my lunchtime view.
Hello, and welcome to me on a beanbag in a pool. I thought I would do a little video and tell you the top 10 things I wish I knew about Bali before I came. Number one, the monkeys are not your friends. You'll see the monkeys all over Instagram. There's this really famous photo where like it looks like the monkey has the camera and everyone's in the background. I don't recommend taking that photo because what's actually happening in that photo is that people are at monkey forest or they're at some kind of temple where the monkeys run rampant. They jump on you, they scratch you, they steal your things, they'll take anything out of your hand that they can get. And in that photo, what's happening is that there are some Balinese people and they are taunting the monkeys with food. And they're holding the food behind the camera and then they take the photo. Basically, you are then contributing to monkey madness. Monkeys are not your friends. They're aggressive, they're pests, but they're really cute from afar. Number two, the ATM machines. They will first give you your cash and then they will ask you, do you want to make another transaction? You have to press the no button and then they give you your card back. But it just isn't intuitive. So there are so many people that once they get their cash, they just leave the ATM and they end up leaving their ATM card inside the ATM.
Hope and I went to the ATM. We were having the best time in the air-conditioned ATM and she left her card in the ATM.
And walked away with my money, all jolly and happy, but now I wanna cry.
So always make sure you have your ATM card before you leave the ATM. Number three, how to get around. I drive a scooter, so I can easily hop on a little bike and zip around my neighborhood. But for long distances, I don't recommend driving a motorbike. There are people that will disagree with me, but I'm personally not comfortable driving an hour in Bali traffic on a motorbike or a scooter. So what you're gonna do is you're gonna use Bali's form of Uber. So we have Grab Taxi and we have Gojek. It's just like the Uber app. You order a car or a motorbike taxi on the app. However, you can't use this app everywhere. In places like Ubud, where I am right now, the local economy is really delicate, so they don't allow Grab Taxi and Gojek to pick up here. And in that case, you need drivers. You need your own drivers on your messenger app that you can call when you need quick rides, long rides, or that you want to do long-term trips with. That brings me to number four. Before I came to Bali, I wish I had my driver connections. It's as easy as asking someone for recommendations. I have my own driver recommendations that I always give. I'm gonna put those guys' information below. Not only are they trustworthy drivers who drive safely, who have a nice car, who are enjoyable to spend your day with, but they also have a lot of great recommendations. You wanna make sure that when you're spending the day with a driver, that he's not taking you to these super touristy places just so that he can get a commission off of bringing you there. You want the guys that are really in it to have a good time, show you a good time, and keep you safe. Number five, the infamous Bali belly. Bali belly is what you'll hear people complaining about when they come to Bali and they get a really bad stomach situation. And the problem is that your stomach doesn't have the right bacteria to fight off this foreign bacteria. When I came to Bali, I got Bali belly one time and it was really brief, because I've been living in Asia for so long. But if you're new here, you need to know how to prepare for Bali belly. And it's really as simple as activated charcoal. Activated charcoal is this black powder that basically what it does, it's not like Imodium where it stops you from going and it's not anything else that like makes you go. It basically encases any bad bacteria that are in your stomach and just hangs out with them until they are naturally out of your body. So it's going to simmer down any Bali belly that you have and it's gonna get you through it a lot quicker. You can get charcoal tablets on Amazon before you come here to Bali, or when you get here you can find charcoal powder, and basically what you do is you can put it in a smoothie or you can put it in water. It doesn't taste like anything, it just has like a weird texture. So I'll actually give you a link to some charcoal down below, and if not, you want to look for a place called Bali Buddha here in Bali and they'll have charcoal powder for you. And on that note, number six is don't drink the water. You can't drink the water in Bali, and if you do, you are going to seriously regret it. Tipping is not customary or expected. If you get in a Grab Taxi or a Gojek and they take you from point A to point B, you pay them the rate and the job is finished, it's done. If you go to a restaurant, you pay for your food, tipping is also not expected. But there are some instances where I do tip. I usually will tip an extra 20,000 for a massage, or if I've had a day out with one of my drivers who were most likely taking tons of pictures and holding my bags and running and getting me water, I usually tip them just because I love them so much and I see how hard they work. So let's say they did a day for me for 400 or 500K, I usually give them an extra 100K, which is about like $6, $7 for the day. It's not going above and beyond to tip them, but in general, it's if you feel it, do it. And if you don't, then don't. No one's gonna hate you for it. Number eight, Balinese culture is extremely spiritual. So don't be surprised if when you visit, there's some kind of spiritual holiday happening. There's Nyepi, which is a silent day where literally everything closes. The internet is off, lights are off, there's no noise, even the airport closes for 24 hours. Or some sort of village ceremony where your driver might say, hey, I can't pick you up today because we have a village ceremony. And you'll drive down some streets and it is just packed with hundreds of people wearing white, carrying these blessings that they're gonna take to the temple. This is just a really spiritual island. And when you come here, it's better to just get prepared for it, like get into it, see a healer, go do a water ceremony, learn how to do a proper Balinese blessing. It's such a huge part of the culture here. Bali is more than beaches and shopping and having beers at sunset. Number nine, visas in Bali. When you get to the airport, if you are from a Western country like America, Canada, the UK, New Zealand, Australia, you can just land, go straight from the plane to immigration, and you can get through with just a stamp in your passport, and you get 30 days here. That's called a 30-day visa on arrival. But if you want to stay for 60 days, what you're going to do is this. You get off the plane, and right before you get to immigration, you'll see the long lines of people queuing up for immigration. That's where the people stamp your passports. There is a desk in the middle of the airport, in the Bali airport, and you go there and you pay about 500,000 IDR, which is, I'm going to put the conversion there. Or maybe it's there. And you pay that, and now what you have is a 30-day visa, but you can extend it for an extra 30 days. So altogether you have a 60-day visa. So they'll give you that little sticker in your passport, then you walk to immigration, and you go through as normal. And number 10, last but not least, treat yourself to VIP airport service. For $30, $30, you can get VIP airport service when you land in Bali. So I found this service online when I was in Kuala Lumpur, and I was like, there's no way that they're gonna give me a free Mercedes pickup on the tarmac for $30. Guess what happened? Our plane lands. When your plane is the kind, which happens a lot in Asia, that your plane lands on the tarmac, they bring a set of stairs up to your plane, then you go down and you hang out on the tarmac until a big bus comes to take the whole plane to the terminal. But when I got off the plane, there was a lady waiting with my name on a sign, and she took me, I got to pass everyone that was waiting for the bus and get into like this Mercedes van and basically be like, bye. And everyone was watching me and I felt so special, it was so cool. And she doesn't leave you until you find your driver, which is another thing that can be pretty overwhelming. When you get to the Denpasar airport, there are hundreds of drivers just like yelling people's names, like maybe they'll have your name on a sign, but it's just so overwhelming. So your concierge makes sure that you find your driver. You can also ask her when you're getting there, hey, I need to go to the ATM, can you show me where? Or you can say, hey, I need to get a SIM card for my phone, can you show me where? And she'll walk you through that too. So you guys, $30 to have this VIP service is unbelievable. That this service is called TIC Bali, and again, link in the description. Okay, that's it. That is the 10 things that I wish I knew before I came to Bali, and now you know. Don't forget that I write the number one travel guide book series for women, including Bali, which is my bestseller. And this is an island that you should definitely study a little bit before you come. Don't forget to like this video, don't forget to subscribe, and don't forget to visit me on Instagram. I'll see you guys in the next video. Bonus thing that you should know before you come to Bali is that floating breakfasts are a thing. This is basically a breakfast in the pool, like so. And most resorts or pools will offer floating breakfast. And the questions I always get are, isn't it uncomfortable to eat breakfast in a pool? Doesn't your food float away? Aren't your hands wet? No, not really. You know, you're usually eating breakfast with the water just up to your stomach, so it's just like breakfast, but in your bathing suit. And when you're in your bathing suit, you can drink alcohol anytime. That's it. See you guys later.